Hello, I'm Dr. Mark Hong. Thank you for joining our Prostate Cancer Awareness Month journey. Let's continue with how common is prostate cancer, who gets it, and what you can do to prevent getting it. Listen up, the next few minutes could change your life. As we learned about in our last video, cancer happens when cells go wild. So, how common is prostate cancer? Prostate cancer is the most common cancer in men other than skin cancer. About 300,000 men are diagnosed in the United States each year with prostate cancer, which is about the same as women who are diagnosed with breast cancer yearly. 1 in 8 men are diagnosed with prostate cancer in their lifetime. That's like flipping this coin 3 times. And each time, it comes up heads. That's a 1 in 8 chance. The real question is, what are the things that make us more likely than the average guy to get prostate cancer? And of course, maybe there's some things that we can do to reduce that chance if we know about it. In medical speak, we call these risk factors. For years, we've known certain things increase your risk of getting prostate cancer. First, your age. As you get older, your risk of developing prostate cancer increases, going from a 1 in 8 chance at age 50 to a 1 in 6 chance after age 65. Sucks to get old, right? Also, we know prostate cancer is more common in African American men, and African American men tend to get more aggressive forms of prostate cancer at an earlier age, starting at age 40 or 50. On the other hand, Hispanics and Asian Americans get it less often. We think maybe early exposure to soy-based foods could be protective for guys like me of Asian descent. Let's stop here and think about that for a sec. Soy gets a bad rap. In the breast and prostate cancer world, everyone gets really jittery when we talk about soy consumption. To the point that many oncologists recommend their patients to avoid soy-based foods. Like what? Other than soy has been an essential part of the Asian diet for thousands of years, the scientific evidence shows eating natural compounds in soy-based foods reduces prostate and breast cancer risk. We're talking about the isoflavones and phytoestrogens, which by the way is not the same as human estrogen. Antioxidants, fiber, and protein rich in soy-based foods that are great for us. We're also talking about edamame or soybeans, tofu, miso, soy milk, not soy-derived ultra-processed foods like soy protein powders or bars, which are stripped of their nutritional value. And speaking of my bros at the gym, eating soy will not reduce your natural testosterone or make you grow man boobs. So, if you're concerned about harming yourself with soy-based foods, don't worry. You're much better off eating soy than a hamburger. Let's talk family. If you have a father or brother who is diagnosed with prostate cancer, your chances of getting it just increase 2 to 4 times. Nowadays, it's not just about your first-degree male relatives. It's also about how young they were when they got diagnosed, because of course, the younger they were at diagnosis, the more aggressive their prostate cancer likely was, as may be yours. And let's not forget your mother or sister with breast cancer. Why? Genes. Genetic changes can be passed on from generation to generation, especially the same BRCA or BRCA 1 and 2 genes that increase breast and prostate cancer risk. Other cancers, like ovarian or Lynch syndrome, can also increase risk. Now, there are many commercially available genetic tests out there now, and it could be a great idea to get tested if you have a strong family history of prostate cancer or of these cancers, though you'll want to be careful about interpreting the results appropriately. You can see some of these risk factors you can control, like your diet, and others you can't, like your age, or choosing your parents. Certain environmental and chemical exposures may increase your risk. such as firefighters and Agent Orange exposure in the Vietnam War. By the way, a lot of guys get prostatitis, or inflammation of the prostate, and we know that a pro-inflammatory state can lead to cancer. So it follows that chronic inflammation may trigger prostate cancer to develop. While the studies haven't proven this per se, it's definitely plausible, and we see inflammation all the time on prostate MRIs and prostate biopsy pathology results. Inflammation, precancer, cancer. Well, I wonder what could be done to reduce inflammation in our bodies. I might get the Nobel Prize for this, but perhaps the anti-inflammatory diet? Check out Dr. Andrew Weil's work on the anti-inflammatory diet. Full disclosure, I trained under Dr. Weil for my integrative medicine fellowship, so I'm a bit biased. But no one's biased that eating healthy, meaning whole foods, mostly plants, in moderate amounts, is great for you and could benefit your prostate cancer risk. Lately, more research has gone into the specifics, like low carbohydrate or sugar diets. Some of you may know about lycopene antioxidants found in red vegetables and fruit like tomatoes, watermelon, and pomegranates that have been associated with a lower prostate cancer risk. Of course, I have guys who are almost turning red, gorging on cranberries and red peppers. I don't stop them, because I'd rather have them eat papayas than fried food and processed meat. But let's think about the forest, not the trees. A balanced, healthy diet over a long period of time beats fad or exclusive diets. Finally, get moving. I could quote you many studies that have shown regular exercise to benefit men with prostate cancer, but do you really need a scientific study to tell you that? What's interesting is that exercise may improve your prostate cancer risk, but it also improves your overall quality of life and metabolic health. Maybe with regular exercise, your body becomes less welcoming for prostate cancer to develop or survive, which is important for both prostate cancer prevention and also for men already diagnosed with prostate cancer who are on surveillance or watching the cancer without treating. It's even important for men after treatment who wish to prevent a recurrence of cancer or cancer coming back. And we're not talking about marathons. Most studies seem to encourage 30 minutes a day, though I'll admit that's not always possible. A magic number seems to be 150 minutes of moderate intensity physical activity a week, or 75 minutes of vigorous activity a week. Moderate intensity can be brisk walking, dancing, gardening, doubles tennis, biking slower than 10 miles an hour. Vigorous intensity can be running, hiking uphill, swimming, singles tennis, or riding faster than 10 miles an hour. By the way, you'll notice I haven't talked about pills. A famous study called the Prostate Cancer Prevention Trial enrolled 18,880 American men and followed them for 18 years to see whether taking a medication would reduce their risk of getting prostate cancer. Turns out, this medication reduced the risk of prostate cancer by about one-third, 33%. That's huge. So why isn't every guy in the United States on this pill? Well, it turns out in 2022, over 2.5 million men were taking this drug called finasteride. You may know it better as Propecia, which is taken for hair loss, making finasteride one of the most popular drugs in America. Still, what about the other 163 million men who aren't taking it? Not sure, but at least some of those men likely have concerns for the negative effects of finasteride. We, the professionals, were concerned when the study first came out because more aggressive prostate cancers were being found in the men taking finasteride compared to placebo. Some guys just don't like some of the side effects that can affect sexual function, such as lower libido and erectile dysfunction. I suspect that mostly guys just don't want to take a pill for the rest of their lives. For a cancer, they have a 1 in 8 chance of developing. I'm kind of the same way. I don't like taking pills unless there's a clear purpose with minimal harm or side effects. But if you're known to be at high risk for prostate cancer, you may want to talk with your physician about taking finasteride. You might even grow more hair. Now that we've covered prostate cancer risk factors and prevention, you're wondering, how does prostate cancer make you feel and how do you diagnose it? great questions, which we'll address on our next episode. Sneak peek, it doesn't make you feel any different. Sneaky, huh? So, I encourage you to subscribe here and join us for the next installment in our Prostate Cancer Awareness Month journey. I'm Dr. Mark Hong, and we hope to change your life.